in that news conference, as Giles was just saying, the chief scientific advisor wanted everyone to slow down a bit with this, saying that the individual chances of any vaccine were low, that there were 70 to 80 projects going around. It's interesting, this front page, I did see last week, the Times newspaper had this several days ago, Hope of September. It's come back with the Daily Express. Is there a danger that newspapers might be getting carried away without putting those caveats on the front page if the vaccine works? Then it would need to be distributed and so on.
Yeah, absolutely. So look, the government is right to have a note of caution around this because we all know that the only way out of this is a vaccine. And, you know, social distancing measures of some sort will continue until a vaccine is in place. And, you know, you can't help them jumping on the kind of the bit of hope that's coming out of this. I do think it's incredibly hopeful, however, that the scientific and the research community are going full guns blazing in order to try and come up with a vaccine. And, you know, whether this particular the trials that are being done by the Oxford scientists, whether they work or not, the pace at which the scientific community is working at, I think, is a thing that is hugely hopeful. And the big worry was always, even if they came up with a vaccine, would we be able to produce them at the scale and the level that we needed to in order to distribute them across the world? And I thought the really interesting piece is, irrespective of whether the vaccine actually works or not, the expectation that they could roll out production as quickly as suggested, you know, a million by September, you know, hundreds of millions by the end of the year, I think is really, really hopeful, because the worry was you could come up with a vaccine and then it would take ages to try to get it out to the population. So I think there's lots of cause for hope, but probably a good dose of optimism because, you know, this stuff is really difficult and they are trying to do the near impossible at phenomenal speed.
Let me pick up with Miatta. You are, of course, the chief executive of the New Economics Foundation. So your views on this economic story?
Yeah, I mean, look, so the Office for Budget Responsibility came out with their assessment of the economy. And, you know, they put the kind of the drop in GDP in this quarter at 35%, which is the biggest drop that we have seen for decades. I think they said for 100 years. So it is absolutely phenomenal. And the big debate is whether this is a V. So basically, we have a big dip and then we bounce out of that. Interestingly, the Office for Budget Responsibility, their scenario worked on the assumption that as soon as the lockdown would ease, we would bounce back. And I thought it was quite interesting that the government, the Bank of England, is actually more cautious about it, because it's not wholly clear that that bounce back will be so immediate. And one of the reasons is, you know, the point that Giles alluded to. So if you think about all those businesses that are currently having to borrow in order to kind of cover their costs with the hope that suddenly things return back to normal, you might be able to do that for 1 month, 2 months. The longer the lockdown goes on, the harder that becomes, particularly if you're then worried that actually social distancing measures might mean that there will be a drop in demand that's sustained beyond the lockdown. So, you know, the question of whether businesses bounce back or not, I think, is a big one. And the other big question in this is unemployment. So, you know, the Office of Budget Responsibility is predicting a rise of 2 million. I think that might actually be quite optimistic. And certainly if you think at the rate that, you know, claimants for unemployment benefits have increase or universal credit has increased, 1.2 million people in a matter of weeks. Yeah. It suggests that we are seeing something we have not seen before, and the impact of this will be absolutely profound. And so, you know, very, very quickly, the government is going to have to turn its attention to how on earth it looks to shore up and bolster the economy. Yes. And ensure that we recover in the best possible way.
We've looked at economics. Now we're going to look internationally at the front page of the New York Times. The headline there, China against the world. I just want to read one small paragraph from this. China's heightened us against them mentality is perhaps most apparent in its recent strictures aimed at foreigners. Though the Chinese government denounced racist attacks against Asians overseas, when the outbreak was centred in China, it now casts people from other countries as public health risks. Miatta, let's just mix it up and start with you firstly on this one. Your thoughts on this story?
Yeah, I mean, so look, it's hugely worrying. And, you know, the sort of the article suggests that there is both a kind of deep nationalism that's emerging out of this, as well as a sort of xenophobia. It's in part a kind of defensive thing. The sort of criticism that has been launched at China around the kind of the inception of the virus, the kind of hushing up of the scale of it and not allowing others to prepare in time. It's almost a kind of defensive reaction against that, as well as, you know, the fact that to kind of, if you like, justify the very draconian measures that, you know, not just the Chinese government, all governments are having to take, kind of hindering on a kind of form of nationalism is a way in which the government is trying to kind of ensure that the population are okay or are willing to sort of suck it up. I think, you know, how much validity in it, I don't know. But I do think there is something in moments of fear and worry where people do turn in on themselves and, you know, nationalism, xenophobia, the othering of others is always a byproduct of times of uncertainty, times of anxiety and worry.
Of course.
And, you know, the real tragedy of it, and I don't think it's probably it's a problem that's unique to China. I think you will see it across the piece that when things will be getting very, very tough, and it's as much about the public health crisis as it is the economic crisis, which will be impacting on people's incomes and their livelihoods, people tend to turn against others. And, you know, this particular crisis desperately needs us to look outwards.
Public being treated like children over lockdown. Senior Tories, the newspaper says, angry at cabinet silence on exit plan. And the article contrasts the stance of the British government to the stance of the devolved Scottish government. Are the public being treated like children? We'll go to Miatta first.
So, you know, I think the government are going to come under huge amounts of pressure because I think, you know, the public are completely willing to do the right things. The levels of compliance around social distancing and the lockdown, I think, has been really laudable. But, you know, if you're asking people to basically pause their lives, you need to give them a sense that there is a pathway out of that, and at least you're starting to think about the pathway out of that. And the fact that the government extended it for another 3 weeks, and it's likely they're likely to extend it again, but weren't able to give us any indication when other countries, you know, Macron did, you know, Germany, other countries are trying to say, look, this is our strategy, this is what we're going to do. Yes, there's uncertainty, but this is at least the plan we're going to try and put in place. And the absence of anything, I think, was deeply worrying, and I don't think it's sustainable. I think the government are going to have to move, and they're going to very quickly have to think about how on earth we find a pathway out of this.
Singapore is one of the countries which has been seen to have the virus under control, but the headline does read 623 new virus cases take Singapore tally past 5,000 mark. Miatta, it's obviously interesting that they can count the number of new cases in a very fine way, but and they say these new cases are linked to foreign workers in dormitories, but it shows that no country is out of the woods on this.
No, absolutely. And, you know, it goes to sort of finish the circle, it takes us back to the vaccine, because what we know is that, you know, forms of social distancing, testing, which is absolutely critical and something that Singapore did phenomenally well, can help stem and contain the virus. But until there is a vaccine, we're not out of the woods. And you can find ways to live with it in the short term, but you will have, you know, unless you completely close everything down forever, which is very hard to sustain, you will have these moments where, you know, it can come back and come back into the population. And that's the thing that every country is going to have to battle with until a vaccine is found.
Miatta, your views, should people start wearing masks as the mayor of London suggests, or should they wait to see what the scientific advisers of the government might say? At the moment, they're saying there's no need outside of clinical situations.
Well, look, we don't know if it helps or not, but it certainly doesn't hinder. So I think if it gives certain people, you know, more confidence when they're going out shopping or whatever, then why not? I don't think it hurts. And at this point, we just need to do as much as we can not to make things worse. And anything that can make it fractionally better, we should be trying to do as well.